Hello and welcome everybody. Today we will be solving Cambridge O-level Physics paper 1 multiple choice. The paper the subject code is 5054/11. This is a May June exam of 2021. The hour or it's the time given for this exam is 1 hour. Let's start. So the first question is, a list of various quantities is shown. How many of these quantities are vectors? So the quantities are acceleration, displacement, force, length, mass, and velocity. So let's start. Acceleration, yes, it is a vector quantity because it is in a predefined direction. Displacement, yes, displacement is in a predefined direction. Force, yes, force has a specified direction. Length, no. Length is a scalar quantity. Mass, no. Mass is a scalar quantity. Velocity, yes, velocity is also a vector quantity. It has a predefined direction. So we have a total of 1, 2, 3, 4. So the answer is 4. Second is, a student determines the circumference of a football. Which instrument gives a reading that is the circumference of a football? Scalpers? No. So scalpers are not suitable for measuring a large round object such as a football. Similarly, micrometer? No. Micrometer is again suited for objects, and generally we use micrometers for measuring micrometer dimensions. No. Rule. So ruler is a linear device and it doesn't conform to the surface of the any round surface. I would say that's like a football. So no. A tape. A tape is a device that is used to measure the circumference, that will give us the accurate value of the circumference of the football. Third question. A train starts from a train station at time t equals to 0. The graph shows how the distance between the train and the station varies with time. So we have a distance time graph. On an x-axis we have time. On a y-axis we have distance. So which of the statement about the movement of the train between time t1 and t2 is correct? So time t1 and t2, these two times, at the time instances, is correct. The speed is decreasing as it moving away from the station. So it started from here, so, and it settles from here at this point. So from a distance time graph, remember the slope of distance time graph is the speed. And from this is we can calculate as distance divided by time. Or if, for example, this is d and this is measured as t, we can also write it as change in distance delta t divided by change in time delta t. So this is the slope or the speed of the graph. So between t and t1 and t2, so what is the slope at this point? So the slope at this point is 0. So the speed is 0 at this point. And what is the slope at this point? So there is some value of speed. So yes, speed, some value of speed is there. So some value of speed is there. So we can say that the slope is there. So we can say that the object is having a certain speed. So as we see that initially from speed 0, we can say that the speed is increasing as it moves from t1 to t2 and till it comes to 0. So it increases. So speed is decreasing, decreasing, no, increasing, yes, increasing, yes. So then we can say that, so from its station it started its journey till it reached a point, and from at that point it stopped for a moment and then continued its journey in the opposite direction till it reaches the point from where it started, or zero, or the overall distance traveled by the train is zero. So we can say that the train is moving towards the station, or we can also say that since the slope is negative at this point, the negative slope in a distance time graph shows that the body has traveled some distance, and from a certain distance the body is coming back to its original point. So answer will be D. Fourth question. A coin falls from rest through the air and eventually reaches a constant speed. There is a resultant force acting on the coin due to two forces P and Q as shown in the diagram. What happens to the force P and what happens to the resultant force before the coin reaches a constant speed? So the resultant force acting on the coin, say call it as R, is the difference of between P minus Q. So initially when the coin started following, initial case, it started following, P was 0 and Q was maximum. So as it reached constant speed, basically you can say the terminal velocity. So at terminal velocity, P becomes equal to Q and the resultant force becomes equal to 0. And what is the point? So the resultant force was maximum at this point. So what is happening to the force P? So force P is increasing. So force P is increasing. Resultant force is decreasing. So it is maximum at initial point and 0 eventually. So it is decreasing. So which is the correct answer? C. So a satellite is shown moving around the Earth in a circular path at a constant speed. Which of the arrows shows the direction of force on the satellite? So at constant speed, the centripetal force acting on the satellite would be in this direction. So the answer will be D. So which of the, question 6 says, which of the rows shows the mass and weight of the of an object on Earth's surface? We remember that weight on Earth's surface is equal to mass times G, or the gravitational field strength. So just a mass is 2. For a mass of 2, the weight is should be 20 newtons. Similarly, for a mass of 5, the weight should be 50 newtons. So for 2, 0.2, no. For 2, 10, no. 5, 5, no. 5, 50, yes. This is our answer. Question number 7. Water is added to a measuring cylinder containing 100 centimeter cube of liquid paraffin. The density of paraffin is given and the water is also given. So we have, as the water is added, the level of paraffin rises to 150 centimeter cube. The paraffin and water do not mix. What is the final mass, or the final, or the final total mass of the liquid in the measuring cylinder? So first of all, the total mass is the sum of mass of paraffin plus mass of water. Remember, density is given as rho equals to mass per unit volume. So first of all, mass of paraffin. How we can calculate mass of paraffin? So density of paraffin multiplied by volume of paraffin. So density of paraffin is 8.8 grams per centimeter cube, and volume of paraffin is 100 centimeter cube. So just multiply it by 100 centimeter cube, make sure the units are same, so we get 80 grams of paraffin. Similarly, mass water, density of water multiplied by volume of water. So density of water is 1 grams per centimeter cube. Volume of water, the remaining volume is 50 centimeter cube. So the overall mass of water is 50 grams. So the total mass will be 80 plus 50, 130 grams. So which one is the correct answer? A. So in this question number 8, the horizontal beam is pivoted at point X. The mass of 200 grams rest on the beam as shown. The center of mass of beam is 50 centimeters from the right end of the beam. And the beam is balanced. What is the mass of the beam? So from the right end of the beam, so this is say right end of the beam, this is the left end of the beam, the center of mass is 50 somewhere here, and it is acting downwards. So mass is acting downwards. So technically weight is acting downwards. Weight is equal to mass times gravity. Again, this is weight is acting downwards. So weight is mass times gravity. So this is say, for example, W1, this is my W2. Now, this is point X is the point where we can take the moment. So this is a question of moments. So for a balanced beam, remember, for a balanced beam, the clockwise moments are equal to anti-clockwise moments. So now, what are the clockwise moments? So these are my clockwise moments. My anti-clockwise moments, these are my anti-clockwise moments. Okay, so now clockwise moments. So just simply, so what is the moment around point X? What would be the value? So 10 centimeter, again it is better. So since we have to calculate mass, so do not consider weight. Just simply use the mass in this value. And make sure the length units are consistent. So remember, moment is generally calculated, or the unit of moments are Newton meter. So Newton is a unit of force that comes from the weight, and meter is the distance or the standard unit of length. But we are using centimeter here, and instead of Newton we are using mass, or mass in grams. So just it remains, keep it as such, that eventually you will get the value of mass. So eventually the clockwise moments, so mass is, we do not know the mass of beam multiply by 10 centimeter. Remember, anti-clockwise moment, we get 20 centimeter multiply by 200 grams. So M of beam becomes 20 multiply by 200 divided by 10. So it is 400 grams. So mass of beam is 400 grams. The answer is C. So next question. Again, read this question very carefully. So where on the graph is the limit of proportionality? No, there, it is not asking about range. So generally, the people make mistake that, okay, the proportionality limit is between 0 and O and P, so just O and P. No, the limit, the maximum limit, the point is at, it's at P. So at P, this will be the answer, B. Do not make this mistake, remember. Okay, question number 10. A sealed gas syringe contains a fixed mass of gas. The piston is moved and the volume of gas doubles. The temperature of the gas does not change. What happens to the pressure of the gas? So remember this law, P1 V1 over T1 equals to P2 V2 over T2. So the temperature remains the same, so it means both of them are same. So we are left with P1 V1 equals to P2 V2. So initially, say if it is our initial pressure, is P1, initial volume is V1. So the piston is moved, the volume V2 is twice the volume of V1. So what happens to the pressure? So pressure 1, pressure 2, P2 we have to find out. So P2 we have to find out. What happens to V1? V2. V2 is 2 times V1. So just simply so P2 is P1 divided by 2. So pressure is halved. Question number 10. Which expression for pressure is correct? Remember, pressure, definition of pressure. Pressure is force per unit area, or Newton per meter square. The units are pascals as well. Remember, so force per unit area, force divided by area. So answer is B. So question number 12. At a depth D in seawater, the total pressure experienced by a diver is 2P, where P is atmospheric pressure. At which depth is the pressure 4P? Okay, so let's try to envision something like this. So this is, say, for example, our seabed, and our diver is somewhere here. So this is distance D, and the pressure is P at this distance, and the rest of the pressure is my atmospheric pressure, P atmospheric, and that is also. So the total pressure at this point is 2P. At what depth it would be 4P? So if I go down 1D more, the pressure will be P more. If I go depth D 1D more, the pressure will be another P. Remember, so my total pressure from here to here is 3P, and my atmospheric pressure is P. So my total pressure on the diver at the distance 3D would be 4P. So eventually my total distance is 3D. Okay. Question number 13. The work done by a force on a body is calculated by multiplying force with a quantity Q. What is the value of Q? Remember, work done equals to force multiplied by distance, and that distance is traveled in the direction of force. So this is the definition. So my Q value is the distance. So let's read the distance traveled in the direction of force. This looks correct, but we have to read the other options. The distance traveled perpendicular to the direction of force? No. Velocity in the direction? No way. Velocity in the direction perpendicular? No way. So answer A is the correct one. Question number 14. Some solar panels has a total area of 12 meter square. Each 1 meter square of panel receives 0.85 kilojoules of energy from the sun in 1 second. How efficiency, the efficiency of the panels is 16%. How much power do they produce? So let's see. Power equals to energy per unit time. So we have to find out total energy. So first of all, total energy by the panels. So 0.85 kilojoules multiplied by the total area, that will be the total energy that is there, multiplied by the efficiency. So efficiency is 16%, 16 divided by 100. So the total energy is there, and divide this total energy by time. So time is 1 second. This will be your power. Simple. So answer will be approximately 1.632 kilowatts. So the nearest one is A. So a copper rod, from question number 15 says, a copper rod is heated at one end. Which statement describes how heat transfer occurs in copper? So remember, copper is a metal. Heat transfer in metals occurs with the help of free electrons. Number one and number two point is, the heat transfers from a point of high temperature to a point of low temperature. So let's see. Copper, energetic copper molecules? No. Copper don't have molecules, a metal. Energetic copper molecules? No. We are not going to select the statement again. Energetic free electrons? Yes. Move from cooler end to the hotter end? No. From hotter end to the cooler end is the transfer of heat. So energetic free electrons move from hotter end to the cooler end? Yes. So answer is D. Question number 16. The question number 16 says, the diagram shows a clinical thermometer. Which factor affects the sensitivity of the thermometer? So remember, the constriction, no. The constriction is not responsible for this. So the bore, yes. The bore is responsible. The more narrower the bore, the more sensitive the thermometer is. The more wider the bore, the less sensitive will be the thermometer. The glass tube, no. So eventually, constriction, no. Diameter of the bore, yes, it is an important factor. Length of the glass tube, no. Thickness of the glass tube, no. So eventually, the diameter of the bore. Narrower the bore, or narrower the diameter, more sensitivity, of more will be the sensitivity of the thermometer. Number 17, which row is correct for thermocouple thermometer? Measures very high temperatures. So thermocouple, remember, it uses Seebeck effect, and it consists of two metal junctions which are used to measure, or which basically converts the temperature to voltage and gives us reading of temperature. So when it comes to metals, the metals, we have the ability to measure very high temperatures. So yes, we have the ability to measure high temperatures. Yes. Response quickly to the change in temperature. Yes, thermocouples are generally very sensitive devices. So generally are very sensitive devices. So what would be the correct answer? The answer would be, so yes, they are sensitive devices, so answer will be D. What is the heat capacity of a body? So heat capacity, according to the definition, is the amount of energy required to raise the temperature of a body by 1 degree centigrade. So let's see which is the exact definition or exact statement that says around about this thing. So amount of thermal energy that a body can absorb without melting? No. The amount of thermal energy required to raise temperature of a body by 1 degree centigrade? Yes. The amount of thermal energy required to raise temperature of 1 kg of body by 1. So this is heat, specific heat capacity, specific heat capacity. Remember, do not confuse this thing, these two. This is specific heat capacity, so no. So that, remember, Q equals to mc theta, mc delta T, or so the amount of thermal energy required to raise the temperature of 1 meter cube of body by one. No. So answer is B. Number 19, which statement about water is correct? First of all, at boiling point, water vapor molecules have same kinetic energy as liquid water molecules. So water vapor molecules have same kinetic energy as liquid water molecules at boiling point. Yes, so this statement is correct. Okay, let's see the other ones. Evaporation occurs only at boiling point? No, evaporation occurs at all temperatures. Water molecules become heavier when freezing. When water freezes? Are you joking? No way. This doesn't happen. Water molecules lose all kinetic energy when water freezes? No. Some sort of kinetic energy still remains there with the molecules. So A answer is the correct one. So next one. Question number 20. A water wave in a ripple tank refracts as it moves from deep water to shallower water. What happens to the speed and frequency of the wave as it moves into the shallower water? So remember, the ripple tank is something like this. So this is, for example, your tank, and there you have a block which creates a region. So this is your deep water. This is your shallow water. And there is a source which is basically source of frequency F, which is moving up and down in this tank, and that is generating some waves. So generally, waves would be like something like this. Okay. So now, the frequency. Since our frequency is in the ripple tank, the waves are generated by a fixed frequency source. The frequency remains constant. So remains constant. Yes. So what happens here? So here we see that, or from the figure we see that the lambda, the wavelength, lambda decreases. So lambda 2, you call it lambda 1. So lambda 2 is less than lambda 1. So remember the formula, V equals to F lambda. So if V remains constant, then, if F frequency remains constant, V and lambda are proportional. So if my lambda is decreases, my velocity is, or the speed of my wave will be decreasing. So my speed will be decreasing. So the answer will be A. Question number 21. It says light refracts from liquid into the air as shown. The refractive index for light moving from air to liquid is 1.4. So remember, it's very simple. So it is N1 sine of theta 1 equals to N2 sine of theta 2. And this is our Snell's law. Now the important aspect is that you have to select the angles properly. So angles are with respect to the normal. So this is my normal. So this angle is 58 degrees. This angle is, this is the angle which we have to find out. So this angle 58, because this is a right angle triangle. So 90 minus 32 is 58. So this is my N1 region. This is my N2. So my N1 region, air, has a refractive index of 1. N2 has a refractive index of, the liquid has a refractive index of 1.4. So simply, N1, air, refractive index of air, sine of angle of theta is 58 degrees. N2, 1.4, sine of theta 2, this is my theta 2 basically. And theta 2 is what we have to calculate. So theta 2 is sine inverse of sine 58 degrees divided by 1.4. Theta 2 is 37.282 degrees. So nearest one is 37. 37 degrees. So this is our answer. So remember, the one of the mistakes people make here is not to check the mode of the calculator. Make sure the mode in the calculator is in radians, is in degrees, not in radians. So if you're using a radian mode, your answer will be seriously messed up. Now, question number 22, red light in air enters a semicircular block. Which diagram shows partial reflection and partial reflection and refraction by the ray of light? So again, this is D shape is the glass block or a semicircular block. Again, it is a denser medium, so light is coming from air from a rarer to denser medium and then going out to the rarer medium. So remember, air, this is a rarer medium, this is a denser medium, this is again a rarer medium. So again, it's coming on the 90 degree angle, it will go as such. So all the rays are going fine. So first part it's seeing. Then it will, at this boundary, there will two things will happen, reflection and refraction. So reflection, so the angle of incidence must be equal to angle of reflection. So this is not equal to that. Again, similarly, if I draw 90 degree here, so this is not, these two angles are not equal. So at this point, again, if I have to check, angle of incidence, angle of reflection are equal. At this point, angle of incidence, angle of reflection appears to be equal. So I can say C and D are my good options. So the next point is the refraction. So how refraction will be happening? So if a light ray is entering from a denser to rarer medium, it will move or it will bend away from the normal. So this is my normal. So this is my normal. So the bending of this light ray is away from the normal. So this is more suited for our case. So denser, if a light ray enters from denser to rarer medium, it bends away from normal. This is a general rule which you can remember to solve these questions. Next question, 23. Which of the statement about human vision is correct? First says, a normal eye, the image in a retina is magnified and upright. No. So it is not magnified. It is less in size compared to the actual image and it is inverted. Remember, it is inverted in a normal eye and it is not magnified. So first is not the right answer. In a long-sighted eye, distance object from images in front of the retina. Remember, this thing happens for short-sightedness. Basically, long-sightedness near, or you can say the near objects are in front of the retina. Then we have short-sighted eyes produce only virtual images. No. The virtual images are not produced by eyes. Similarly, short-sighted is corrected by using diverging lens. Yes, that is the thing, or what we can use it, the concave lens at which basically used to compensate the overconvergence of the eye, overconvergence of the sight eyesight, which happens in short-sightedness. So yes, D is our answer. So white light enters a prism and forms a spectrum. The rays in the air are labeled. Which diagram shows the white light is dispersed in the prism? So remember, white light enters from rare to denser medium, it will refract. So first point, the light is not refracting. Light is not refracting as it's in the prism. So these are not the answers. So again, light is refracting inside the prism, reflective inside the prism. Yes. So now remember, Vibgior, and remember that the red light bends the least, violet bends the most. So this is your answer. 25, question number 25. The sound from a ship is reflected by a cliff. An echo is heard by the sailor on a ship 4 seconds after the sound is made. The speed of the sound in air is 320 meters per second. How far is the cliff? So for example, this is your boat. And this is your cliff. Sound goes from here and reflects back. So the time taken by sound to reach is 4 seconds. And and distance equals to speed into time. Speed is 320 multiplied by, so now the time basically is, so distance covered is this and this, so you have to divide it by 2, half of the time. Or if you have to multiply it by 4, so you have to do it 2 times the distance, distance this and this. So distance is, distance will be 320 multiplied by 4 divided by 2, so answer will be 640 meters. So answer will be 640 meters of B. Question number 26. End of X and X of a metal rod attracts north pole of a compass. Which of the statement about the rod is correct? It is made of copper and initially magnetized. No, the copper is not a magnetic material. That is used as a test case. It's very difficult to magnetize copper. So no, it is not even. Again, the copper part, you must just simply ignore it. The copper is non-magnetic material and it's very difficult. It is made up of steel. Yes, steel is steel can be magnetized and it is not initially magnetized. So if steel is not magnetized, the north pole of the needle induces the south pole on the pole. So it will attract. So this can be an option. It is made up of steel. Yes, and it's a north pole. So if it's a north pole, it will repel. So it's not attract. So again, answer C is the correct one. Question number 27. Which diagram shows the pattern of direction of electric field lines near a positive charge? So from a positive charge, the lines are, or electric field lines go out of the positive charge. So answer is A. Question number 28. A positive charge rod is held close to an insulated metal sphere. The sphere is earth as shown. The earth connection is removed and then the rod is removed. Which diagram shows the charges on the sphere after the rod is removed? So remember, the rod is positive charge, so it will induce negative charges by the electrostatic induction, and this is the earth terminal over here. So earth will not go over here because the charges which are transferred on this side will be, or the electrons from the earth will come and will nullify these charges. So first you remove the earth wire and then you take off the metal rod, take away the metal rod. So what will happen? These charges will redistribute over the sphere. So when they redistribute over the sphere, they will look something like this. So what is the nearest form of this thing? I think it's C. So C. Remember 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 1, and 6 are there. So a couple of charges will be lost. So that is the most accurate one. 29. Question number 29. So what does this question say? It says that the diagram shows an electrostatic precipitator. It can be used to remove dust from the air. What happens at the negative grid? So negative grid. So what is happening? Basically, these are positive plates, and these dust particles are attracted to these positive plates. It means that they are negatively charged. When they passed the negative metal grid, they become charged, and since they are attracted to positive plate, it means that the charge is negative. So dust particle gains electrons, yes, gain electrons or either lose electrons. There is nothing that is related to proton. So remember, negative charges or a negative charge is basically gain of electrons, A part. Question number 30. 100 watt lamp is switched on for 5 hours for each day for 3 weeks. 3 weeks, 100 watts. The cost of unit is this. How much is the cost to run the lamp? Remember, the cost is always measured, or the unit of electricity is kilowatt hours, or which is the unit against which we are built is kilowatt hours. So we have to find out the kilowatt hours which are consumed by using a 100 watt bulb. So kilowatt hours are 100 watts for 5 hours in one day, and for 1 week multiply by 7. So this is 1 week, and multiply by 3. So this is for 3 weeks. So this is basically watt hours. This will give you watt hours, and you have to divide it by 1000 to make it kilowatt hours, and then multiply it by 0.24. Okay, so the nearest answer, the answer you will be getting is $2.52. This answer C. So the information on the back of an electric, question number 31 says, the information on the back of an electric room heater is shown. So rating is shown, frequency is shown, and the current is value of currents. What is a suitable fuse rating for this room heater? Remember, 4.2 is the operating current. If a fuse is less than 4.2, the room heater won't work. The fuse will blow every time it reaches its operating current. So then we want it to protect it again. We want to protect against overcurrents. So just a value of current that is more than that, that is 5 ampere, will be sufficient for that. Question number 32. It says, the diagram shows a rectangular wire coil WXYZ between two poles of a magnet. So we have this magnet. There is a current in the coil in the direction shown. What statement is correct? So remember, this is a motor. And for motor, if you have to, you can use Fleming's left hand rule. So with the left hand rule, your middle finger points towards the direction of current. Your first finger points from the direction of north pole to south pole, and thumb will be pointing towards the direction of rotation of the coil. So WX, the side WX, experience an upward force. If we apply Fleming's left hand rule, yes, it looks like this, and this point goes like this. So yes, it looks correct. XY experience a force. This side will not experience a force. This is in parallel with the magnetic field. It is in parallel with the magnetic field. So both sides won't experience any force. YZ experiences YZ experience an inward force. YZ experience an inward force. No, the force is not inwards. It would be downwards. ZW experience a downward force? No, we will not experience. So answer A is the correct answer. 33. Which energy transfer takes in an electric kettle? So in an electric kettle, usually have, say for example, water. You are boiling a water, so you are basically converting using electrical energy to heat the water. So the final output is heated water. So energy is converted from electrical energy to heat energy. Again, question number 34. The diagram shows the current carrying conductor between poles of a magnet. The force on the wire acts downwards. So force is acting downwards. So this is my force. Again, remember, you have to use the left hand rule. So for a left hand rule, if my four changes are possible. Which two changes made together keep the force acting downwards? So for example, this is the left hand. If I apply the left hand rule, so my middle finger will be pointing in the direction of current. This will be my north pole. This will be my south pole. So what will happen? So a current, if I increase the current, the force will keep on, will be downwards. Yes. If I increase, if I use a stronger magnet, force will be downwards. Yes, the force will be downwards. If the direction of current is reversed, so if I change the direction of the current in the similar scenario, the force will be reverse. Okay, and the poles exchange its position. So it means that if I change the direction of current and the poles, the force 2 or 3 together will make another the force downwards as well. 1, 2 together will make the force downwards together. Okay, so either 1 and 2 or 3 and 4 would be my answer. So 1 and 3, no, 1 and 3 won't be the right combination. 2 and 3, again, it won't be the right combination. 2 and 4, again, it won't be right combination. 3 and 4, yes, this will give, it will make this as south pole, this as north pole, the direction of current will be here, so and the direction of force will be again pointing, if I use my Fleming's left hand rule, the thumb will be pointing towards the force, and that would be downwards. So the answer would be D for this question. Question number 35. In an alternating current or AC generator, a magnet rotates near a coil of wire. The induced electromagnetic force in the coil is displayed on an oscilloscope screen. What trace is produced as the magnet slows down? So what will be happening? So a magnet is, for example, this is my coil, and this is a magnet north south, and that is rotating across this coil, for example. So as it slows down, what will happen? First of all, my amplitude, or the voltage amplitude of the EMF generated, will decrease. So which of the graph shows the amplitude decreasing? So amplitude is not decreasing, amplitude is not decreasing, amplitude is increasing, so amplitude is decreasing. So first of all, this is the most right answer in that. The second case is, as it slows down, the overall frequency, so for example, if it's rotating with a constant speed, the output would be a completely sinusoidal wave with a constant frequency and wavelength. So as it slows down, the wavelength starts increasing, and overall the amplitude starts decreasing or dying down, or a damping effect. So eventually the answer D appears the most closest one. So question number 36, it says the student uses a transformer to light a filament of 230 volt AC. The lamp has maximum voltage rating of 6 volt. So 10 ratio is N1 and the 10 ratio of is N2. So the 10, so we remember that for V1 by V2 is N1 by N2. And what we have to find, what happens when the circuit is switched on? So let's do the calculations first. So the ratings, so the lamp is rated at 6 volts. It means that it can only handle 6 volts, not more than that. So 300 volts, 300 turns here, 20 turns here, 230 volts here. So 300 by 20 multiply by, so V1 by V2. So if I have to find out V2, it would be 230 multiply by 20 divided by 300. This. So a V2 is approximately 15 point something something. Okay, so it is something 15.3 to be very exact, 3.33 volts. So in this case, when this is switched on, 15 volts will appear across this terminal. So what will happen to the switch? So the lamp will immediately or brighten up immediately, and it will fuse. So it will lamp lights up brightly and goes out. So the answer is D. So question number 37, which statement about nuclear fission is correct? So nuclear fission occurs at low temperatures? No, it occurs at high temperature. Nuclear fission occurs only between heavy nuclei? Not necessarily. Nuclear fusion occurs in the formation of stars? Yes. Nuclear fusion occurs at the in the formation of stars? Yes. Nuclear fusion powers most electric generating stations? No. It is nuclear fission. Fusion, not fusion, it is fission that powers most nuclear stations. So the answer is C. Question number 38. In one radioactive decay, a radium-226 decays to radon-222 as shown. Which particle is produced? So for example, the particle is this. 226 goes to 224. So the 4 is here, 2 over here. So this is basically a simply alpha particle. This is alpha particle. So remember, alpha particle is 4-2. So it is a alpha particle. 4 protons and 2 neutrons. Similarly, Question number 39. A count rate from a radioactive source falls from 400 counts per minute to 500 counts per minute in 72 minutes. What is the half-life of the source? So remember this formula. Nt, N naught, 1 by 2 power T over capital T. So your capital T is half-life. Nt is the amount of the radioactive source that is remaining after time t. So amount of radioactive source is directly proportional to the counts we are having. So initial counts were 4000, again 1 by 2, t was 72 minutes, so keep it as such. So half life in minutes would be his. So 5000 divided by 4000 equals to 1 by 2 power 72 by capital T. This it is 1 by 8. So 1 by 8 can be written as 1 by 2 power 3, 1 by 2 power 72 by T. So 3 is basically equal to 72 by T. So from here, T becomes equal to 24 minutes. So answer is D. So half-life is 24 minutes. So again, which particle are found inside the nucleus of an atom? So nucleus of an atom consists of protons and neutrons. So the answer is D. The answer is D. So now, so here is, we have solved our paper number 1, physics of 5054 for 2021 May-June.